क्या आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर रहे हैं और कोचिंग इंस्टीट्यूट को 2.5 लाख तक की फीस नहीं पे करना चाहते? अगर हाँ तो 22,500 रुपए में घर बैठ के StudyIQ के पेनड्राइव कोर्स के साथ आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर सकते हैं। आज ही विजिट करें studyiq.com।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, आई एम प्रशांत मावानी। आई होप यू आर डूइंग गुड दिस मॉर्निंग। लेट्स हैव अ पॉजिटिव स्टार्ट। ईच डे आई कम इन विद अ पॉजिटिव एटीट्यूड, ट्राइंग टू गेट बेटर। दिस इज समथिंग दैट वी नीड टू टेल आवरसेल्व्स एवरी डे, एंड इफ वी टेल दिस थिंग टू आवरसेल्व्स ऑन रेगुलर बेसिस, देन व्हाट विल हैपन? आवर फर्स्ट स्टेप विल बी in a positive direction, and this will stay with us throughout our day. With this, dear friends, the first item that I have got for you guys is reality check. It is based on election. Now, the reason why it is in news is because Chief Election Commissioner O.P. Rawat has recently said that it is not practically possible for us, you know, to have simultaneous elections in forthcoming future. Because if I talk to you about this end of this year, end of 2018, then Mizoram's or this Mizoram government's 5 years are coming to an end on 15th December. So election is something that is required over there. The same thing goes with Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan. As you can see, starting of 2019, we are going to see elections taking place in at least three different states. And then we are going to have elections for our Lok Sabha as well, isn't it? Big general election going to take place next year. So if we are, or if people are demanding, you know, political parties, and if people are demanding that we go for the simultaneous election, then that is something that is practically not possible. And this is a very realistic assessment done by, of course, our Chief Election Commissioner. The problem with normal election, or this election process that we have at present, and simultaneous election, if we compare basically both these methods, right, then you find positives and negatives, pros and cons of both things. I'll give you a couple of pros and cons of both the things, and I will leave it on you guys, you know, in future. If you read something that is associated with simultaneous election, then I strongly reckon you guys to keep note of that article. If you're reading online, then make sure you save that article or something, you know. So the reason is that you need to have good clarity on positives and negatives, and you need to form your view as well. And of course, I will help you with that thing. So if we talk about elections, the problem with our country is that most of the time we are in election mode. There are so many studies conducted on this thing, and it has been said that on an average, out of 5 years, right, we spend 1 year after election. And you know this thing very well, that when MCC, that is Model Code of Conduct, when this Model Code of Conduct is applied in any given area or state, after that, you know, the whole energy of administration will be invested, or you can say it will be diverted in conducting elections rather than development and growth and other things. So you can say that out of 5 years, on an average, if we take our whole nation, then we find that in 5 years, like every 5 years, 1 year is gone just for election. I'll give you a couple of examples. Last year we saw what, Gujarat, Himachal Pradesh, then we saw this year Karnataka. At the end of this year, we are going to see Mizoram, and next year starting, as you know. So you can imagine, right, if you take an average, and then 2020, you will find some states going for election, 2021, 2022. So it goes on every year. So this is the thing. If you talk about our security forces, then good thing and bad thing. Good thing will be that if we have simultaneous election, then for a week or something, we are going to have election, and after that, the job will be done. So our security forces, they can focus on their core duty, that is to provide security, or, you know, to create this secure environment for our country, rather than running here and there after providing this protection and other things for elections. So this can be, of course, a positive thing. The negative thing is that do we have enough boots? We don't have that many, you know, central police personnel or central paramilitary personnel. We don't have that many of them boots that can handle this simultaneous election. So you have negative and positive thing. The other thing is we would require VVPATs. We would need what, 24 lakh VVPATs. Somewhere around, we at present we have what, 12 lakh VVPATs. So we need double of that. So again, this is not practically possible for us to produce 12 lakh VVPATs in such a short time. And constitutional amendments will be required because, you have to get green signal from parliament, which is very important. You will need a special majority here. At the same time, out of 29 states, that we have in our country, at least 50% out of these 29 states, their legislative assembly should give a green signal to this amendment. Only after that we would be able to see this thing as a law, simultaneous election, because we have to make constitutional amendments. We have to, come out with these rules and regulations that your term as a state government, it can be shortened, it can be extended, just to achieve this target of simultaneous election. And then there are so many other questions as well that we need to ask ourselves, like what will happen if the confidence, or if the central government will lose confidence? Will we have election throughout the nation for all states and a general election, or it is just a general election that we will have? And then you will have other problems. Say, for example, if you are electing a government that will stay for 3 years only after this new rules and regulations. So we don't think so we will be able to, see that many changes in 3 years' time. And then a good government can lose, that chance as well. So there are so many things that these political parties, they have to brainstorm on. They, of course, we too, because this will impact our lives as well. Now, the last point that I would like to add here, and then we will conclude this discussion on this reality check editorial. And the last item is that there are so many other electoral reforms that are required, right? Who wins election in our country? A person or a party having muscle power, a person or party having money power, right? This is a dark reality of our society, that only rich people who can afford, either they have this muscle power, that means they have enough manpower, or it's sad to say that we find goons as well becoming our political leaders or representative of people. And then we find money power. It is something that is very important. So, of course, society, we need to change the mindset of our society. And only after that we would be able to see a political change. And as a society, if we start demanding, clean politicians, If you start demanding clean politician, then these political parties, they will have no option at all, right? They will have no option at all whatsoever, right? They have to field someone who is clean, who is honest, with integrity, good decision maker. Because of this muscle power and money power, these are the criteria, unofficial ones, of course, but these are the criteria that are required. And because of this thing, we don't find good people entering into politics. So that's a big loss for us. So there are other things, paid news, and all these things are very much important for electoral reforms, rather than just focusing our whole attention on simultaneous election. But this, dear friends, this is my Facebook page here, and this is my Twitter handle if you want to download, just in case, the PDF of today's lecture. I will share it on both this platform here, and you can also hit the like button, or you can follow me so that you will get all these important updates associated with me and my lecture on real-time basis. And then we have a second item that is again very important, India and neighborhood relationship. It is about sovereignty and sensitivity. Very easy to understand article, but yet very important. Now, dear friends, sovereignty and sensitivity, it is about Bhutan and India. So let me take you through Bhutan very quickly. As you can see here, Thimphu is its capital here, and you can see that Bhutan is a state that is sharing its border with the land boundary with our country. So here is India surrounding Bhutan, and here is Sikkim. So I'm sure you know which part of our country that we are talking about. We are talking about this northeastern part of our country. And then you can see that Bhutan is also sharing its border with Tibet or China. Now, it was in news for not that good reason, but this region here, it was about Doklam. This region is Doklam, and I'm sure regular listeners, you are very much aware about this geography of Bhutan. So what I will reckon to new students is spend, not even new students, if you are following it for quite a bit of time now, then as well, you should at least spend 5 minutes, right? Spend 5 minutes after this map here, observe, you know, mountains of Bhutan, try to, you know, remember their names and go through different cities and talk, go through, open your atlas and observe this, you know, wildlife sanctuary that you see on your screen and things like that. Then I have a physical map of Bhutan, and you can see it is part of this lesser Himalayas. You can see many rivers as well flowing or originating in Bhutan and entering into India. So keep the name of these rivers handy as well. And then you can see this Kuru River, and then you see this Drangme River. They coalesce here, you know, they become one here, and then they become one with this Tongsa River, and then this Tongsa River is entering into our country. So keep this river in mind. And as far as this Drangme River is concerned, it is originating from Tibet portion of China. Now let us go through this article here, Sovereignty and Sensitivity. It is in news because recently, you know, this Border Roads Organization, BRO, that is of course an Indian organization, Army's department of producing roads. So this BRO is helping Bhutan to, you know, create this infrastructure, roads and other things under this project Dantak. And it has created a bit of controversy back in Bhutan because BRO decided to use a tricolor highway marker stickers. You know, the safety stickers that you find on this dividers, or you find it on, you know, on the hilly area when you have this fence that is protecting your road. These stickers were resembling Indian flag, not exactly Indian flag, but has this three colors, this saffron, white and green. So opposition parties, they have you know, they have and there are people out there, it is a talk of the town in Bhutan on social media and other places, that are we getting colonized by India? Of course, India will never colonize any country, but this is something that no country will accept, isn't it? Then too much of boards talking about government of India on their highways and other places. So all these things are heightening the sensitivities, and it is, you know, general elections are just around the corner in this Himalayan kingdom of Bhutan. And these people, right, people of Bhutan, they are, you know, they means every one of us, we love our freedom. But when it comes to sovereignty of their country, when it comes to, you know, freedom of their country, strategic autonomy of Bhutan, they are very much sensitive about it. Because if you go back in the history of Bhutan, you find that it used to be, you know, a monarchy. But I think it is the only country in the world, if I'm not wrong, then the only where the king or the monarch himself, you know, came out and he said that enough of monarchy, let's go for democracy. Can you believe this thing? Because in the most developed countries as well, you find that kings will step down or queens will step down only after a sort of protest. But nothing like this took place, in, you know, during calm time where everything was going all right. At that point of time, the king offered, you know, to step down and go for, go ahead with this democracy. So you can understand how much freedom, you know, they are getting or they have in their own culture. They love their environment as well. And it's in their constitution that they need to keep this much amount of somewhere around 50% or something is given there in their constitution, that 50% of area of Bhutan should be under forest. You should not, you know, interfere with the nature. And if you find leopard or bear or something entering your society, then rather than over here, people will start throwing stones over here, or they will pop out to see that bear and leopard. But in Bhutan, people do pay respect. They will step inside their home so that that animal as well can peacefully pass away. So this is how they are living their life. They are very much, you know, their whole lifestyle is also very, very green. If you see their dressing as well, then it is very green. Of course, I don't want to go into all those details here. but their way of life is with keeping a fine balance with nature. And India is supporting Bhutan in various different fields. We have supported them for hydropower because it is an Himalayan nation, so you know that you have this potential of because of these rivers here, you have huge potential of hydropower, because Himalayan rivers are rivers that have water 24/7, 365 days, isn't it? If you have snowfall, then as well the river will have water. If you have rainfall, then again, and in summertime, your snow will melt down and this will add more water. So they are perennial rivers, right? Perennial means permanent rivers that we find. So permanently you can produce electricity, hydropower. Now, loans are provided by India, but now what we are finding is that Bhutan, people are talking about this national debt, right? How they are going to pay this money back to India. Something similar, the question that we ask for CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. This sort of questions are being asked by the people of Bhutan. And so this is again a big problem because elections are just around the corner. Opposition parties are blaming Prime Minister of Bhutan for being a pro-India and giving India such a deals that are detrimental to Bhutan. This opposition party is of course not happy with India because it was in 2013 when Manmohan Singh government, at that point of time UPA government, decided to cut or block this cooking gas subsidy that we used to give to Bhutan. And because of this thing, the party that was in power at that point of time, it lost election because it was not able to get help from India. So gas subsidy and other things. So this is one of the reasons why they are not happy with it. At the same time, we also need to keep in mind that, you know, this game, this you are my favorite and you are not, this sort of game that we play here in our neighborhood, like for say example, Sheikh Hasina, with whom we have very good relationship, right? But when it comes to Rajapaksa of Sri Lanka, we don't share that friendly relationship with him. So because of this yes and no, and you know, you are close to me and you are not close to me, this sort of attitude that we are playing in this SAARC region is something that is noted very closely by Bhutan, and there are people who have started protesting against this thing. So this is going to be a bit of problem for our country as far as India's power surplus status is concerned. You know, this will create troubles for Bhutan because Bhutan, it gave its green signal for this hydropower so that it can sell this electricity that it is producing to different countries and it can make money out of it. But now India itself is going ahead with this projects, and India, you know, our capacity in renewable energy is going up and up. So there are, you know, it is going to create problem because we are not going to purchase this thing from Bhutan in big quantities. So how they are going to pay back this loan? And one more thing, Bhutan has decided that it is going to keep its doors open. If good things are coming from China, then there is no harm in engaging with China. So that's everything about this article. Now moving on to another one. This is about the name of this article is for better slum policies. Slum is something that is available, or I must say rather put it this way, that you find slums in each and every city of our country, even in towns as well, in not in villages, you cannot say slum, but you find this sort of kaccha houses and lack of facility and connectivity, this sort of houses in all different levels of our country. We are living in paradox, as you know, that Mumbai or Bombay is our financial hub. It's a financial capital of our country. It's the richest city of our country, and it is also house for the biggest slum in our country, and if I'm not wrong, the biggest slum in India, in the world as well. If not the biggest, I think the biggest one is in Malaysia, if I'm not wrong. Correct me if I'm right or wrong. But we are in top three as far as slums are concerned. Now, you know, slums are also a den for crimes. I'm not saying that people living in slums are criminals, but it's a bit easier for criminals to operate in slums because things are messy over there, things are unorganized. The other thing is migration is something that is taking place, and most of the people who are migrating, most of them, I'm not saying everyone, but most of them are migrating for, you know, for a better future, for a better life, and they are ready to go through all the pain that they have to go through if, you know, for achieving this livelihood and, you know, that dream life. So when they enter these big cities, of course, they cannot afford houses on rent as well in posh areas. So they opt for these slums. And if we think that after a couple of years of hard work we will be able to step out of it, then that's a very wrong thing, because it's entering into a vicious cycle. Things are a bit more expensive than normal colonies when you compare, you know, slums with it, because water and electricity, let me give you a small example, right? You don't get it legally over there, so you have to get it from gray market, so you have to pay a bit more as well, you know, because you are the ones who are in desperate need of water and electricity, so you'd be paying a bit more than what other people pay in these legal colonies. And our government has started creating, you know, building this tall skyscrapers in which these people living in slums, they can be shifted in these flats. But what about their livelihood? So this is again a thing. Then there are some studies, you know, and the results that we learn from, or the produced by the studies are indicating that we don't have even right numbers as well of people living in slums. As per 2011 census, we have 65 million people, but United Nations Habitats 2014 estimates that we have 104 million. So a 40 million gap is something that is not easy to swallow, right? Something is not right with it. Of course, UN Habitats research is a bit more comprehensive compared to, or their survey is a bit more reliable compared to ours, because they do it in different parts of the world, and they have this team. So we need a proper figure. Without proper data, we cannot formulate policies. 70% of families in slums are living in debt, and on an average it takes 21 years for a person to you know, to come out of this slum. When I say come out, I mean to say to leave this life of slum and to live a proper, or you can say more formal life. But that's not for everyone, because out of 10 households, 7 households are living in slums for nearly 4th generation now. And when it comes to job employment and opportunities, of course, people living in slums, they will be in disadvantage when we compare it with the other residences. So we need better policy for our slums, because we have huge population living in slums. And then we have this why context matters. It is about idea of uniformity. It is about inequality. This article is Reader's Editor, and a few students wrote to Reader's Editor of the Hindu that why we find news items that are saying that a Muslim man was killed and Dalit girl was thrown out of school or whatever. And why you don't write that general category or general caste girl was thrown out of school and murdered? Why you don't add those sort of words? And the reason why, or the reason that the Hindu is giving out, and which I agree with it, the thing is that, see, in our country we have this caste pyramid. Every caste feels that that particular caste is the best. They have all the pros, they have no negativity, you know, so it's a funny thing that in which we are living. Anyways, at the end of the day, we are all Indians, so that is something that is the most important thing, but we hardly go ahead with that identity, isn't it? Most of the time, people will carry this caste identity. We find these stickers, you know, big stickers on motorcycles and on cars, people writing down the name of their caste and etc. whatever. So this is something in a world in which we are living. Now the thing is, when we come to this Hindu newspaper and you know, this reporting Dalit girl or using this Muslim man, Muslim woman, etc., why they need to add this word? The reason is that see, it's a complex relationship, right? We have people in our country who are And you find this sort of people in every society. There are people who are, you know, creating or they are doing this sort of crimes against Dalits, against Muslims, because they have this prejudice, right? They are living in this stereotype and they are promoting hate crimes. So because of this thing, we find or it becomes very much important to specifically write down that hate crime is conducted on Muslims or hate crime is conducted on Dalits or vulnerable section of society. And it is one of the most bedrock or core duty of journalism that damage may it be physical, psychological, right? It should be avoided in the sense the society should be protected from this sort of harm and damages. And this is one of the reason why we cannot, when I say we, I mean to say this, the Hindu newspaper or journalists in general, they cannot report a normal crime with hate crime. You cannot mix them, you know. So that's the thing. Now let me take you through what we have not covered, because or else there will be doubt in your minds, right? So here, this one is covered, now we are not covering these three articles. One reason, this one is about Atal Bihari Vajpayee. We have talked about our late prime minister, you know. So It's about Kargil, it's about Pakistan relationship and peace and things like that. Then we have this long campaign. It is about Indonesia's politics, something that as far as your exams are concerned, you know, you don't have to pay that much attention. You can have a quick glance over it, but you don't have to spend that much after it. And then you have this Chronicle of Collaboration. It is again about, you know, people asking questions about Carnatic music's relationship with church. But here this writer has provided many, many different examples and proof so that we can know about this relationship between church and Carnatic music. With this, dear friends, we reach to news item now. Let's quickly go through it. Its situation is getting, will get better because rainfall, this heavy rainfall has, means that for time being it is not taking place in Kerala. So it's a big relief for people and for security personnel. Daoud's key aid is held in London. And then you have this 6,000 people, they have applied for this lateral entry job as joint secretary. You know that you have 10 posts and 6,000 applications we have received. So let's see how it goes. There are positive things about lateral entry, negative thing, it is as important as your simultaneous poll, so pay attention to that topic. India building new fighter jet will be ready by 2032. Xi Jinping calls for deepening anti-corruption drive in China. Ghani, Ashraf Ghani, of president of Afghanistan, offers Taliban a new ceasefire. Europe's political, this Zarif, who is Iran's foreign minister, he has said that Europe should support Iran, right? They should take some practical steps rather than just talking. And you find here this NABARD comes out with a survey, and this survey indicates that nearly 50% of our agricultural households, they are in debt. So this indicates the situation of our country as well, economic situation, because if 50% of our people are engaged with agriculture and out of that 50% are in debt, then you can safely say that we are in debt. And then we have a golden start, right? Once you download this file, please help yourself with it. I'll take you through some financial news. The most important one that you need to pay attention at is this one, that nearly 140 million electric vehicles could be on road by 2030 in China, India and EU. So in India, we will have some, you know, 18 million vehicles. Out of this 18, you will have what? Electric vehicles will be 11 million and 7 million will be this blue, that is hybrid vehicles. So it's a good thing for us. And then you have other countries too. Moving on to another item, Japan, USA, EU, in total 11 countries are against us in this WTO. They are not happy with the support that we provide to our farmers. So it's going to be a big trouble for India in WTO. These are some of the vocabularies. Please help yourself with it. And these are your kingdoms, right? You have this different families. Al Nahyan looks after Abu Dhabi, through Dubai, Ajman, Umm Al Quwain, and then Sharjah, Rash Al Khaimah, and then you have Fujairah. And Abu Dhabi is, of course, the main capital of this UAE. A question that I have for you guys is this one. Can you identify the country that you can see on your screen? Also, give me the name of the capital of this country. That's everything in today's discussion. These are your two new questions. Please check out studyiq.com to find out more about our pen drive and tablet courses. God bless you all. Enjoy your studies. Do share this lecture with your friends. Do share it on your social networking site. Please don't forget to provide your answer in the comment section. Hit the like button if you have learned something from today's discussion. Thank you very much. Enjoy your studies. Jai Hind.